there. Is today your first time here? Or maybe your first time in a while? If so, maybe you're wondering exactly who we are and what this church is all about. Well, we'd like you to know that we're a group of ordinary people who are on an amazing journey together, following Christ. Our guide is the Bible because it's the divinely inspired word of God, and it will never take us in the wrong direction. Along the way, we hope you'll see that we are welcoming and spiritually passionate, and that getting to know you is a big deal to us. We know that the road is rough sometimes, but we'll work really hard to bring you practical and relevant messages to equip and encourage you through life's ups and downs. We want you to know that we care about this community, and we believe that it's our job to make it a better place. So, no matter who you are or where you've been, we're glad you're here with us today. And we hope that you'll join us on our journey, following Christ and living out His plan for us. So, welcome to church.
Morning, and welcome to the Vineyard Church of Hopkinton. We're happy you're here.
Welcome to Hopkinton Vineyard. We're happy that you're here.
Welcome to the Vineyard.
We're happy you're here.
Welcome to the Vineyard Church of Hopkinton. We're glad you're here.
Welcome to Vineyard Hopkinton.
We're glad you're here.
Hi, welcome to Vineyard Hopkinton. We are glad you're here.
Hey, good morning. So on July 26th at 6 p.m., we are doing a game show night here outside at the church. And you are invited. We would love to have you come. You might remember at the last Christmas at our Christmas party, we did this.
So, Vineyard Hopkinton, give it up for the All-Stars. Come on, Dad. Here we go. Right up here, right up here. Good. Denoy and Carissa, come on down.
Well, get a little bit excited because this year, on July 26th, we're going to do this.
Welcome back, everybody, to The Price is Right. George Gray, let's get another contestant up here. Who you got? Let's see him. Let's see him. Hi, Elvira. How's it going? Elvira, I got good news and bad news. Good news is you're on The Price is Right now. Bad news is you got to go back down there.
Now, you might not be asked to do this.
Okay.
So, see? Out, across, and in.
But you will probably need to do a little bit of this.
Well, I got B-N-A-H-C-O-3, and I know that that is baking soda. And when you put baking soda in the vinegar, it starts fizzing up and it produces carbon dioxide.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay.
July 26th, 6 p.m., game show night here at Vineyard Church of Hopkinton. I'm so excited. It's going to be a lot of fun. Bring a friend. This is a great thing to bring somebody you've been wanting to invite to church. Have them come on out with you. It'll be a lot of fun, lots of laughs. We hope to see you then.
Well, that does look like fun. You know, we've got a bunch of stuff going on this summer. We've got good outdoor space, and we want to utilize the warm weather months at a safe social distance and with precautions to have some fun, like the game show night. We got a campfire going on. We've got folks going all around our community delivering food to folks who may have a little trouble accessing some more traditional networks, but we've got people going around. We went around this weekend delivering food to individual houses in our community. So we've got lots going on, and we've got good stuff for you this morning. We believe that Jesus wants to meet you this morning, wherever you're at. Some of you may be hunkered down for a hot weekend in the midst of your work weeks. I hope you've got a fan. I hope you've got some AC going. Some of you may be accessing us from an exotic location like the Cape or somewhere else where you have Wi-Fi. We believe that Jesus has good things for you. And the most important part of our week, no matter what, is receiving Jesus' love, centering ourselves in that place of what only God can do for us, that place of peace and joy, of praying, some sunshine and some prayer. It's what we need for our week. This morning we are talking about the kingdom of God. It's the big Jesus movement changing individuals and communities. The kingdom of God started small and vulnerable with the birth of Jesus. It suffered what seemed to be a crushing defeat in the death of Jesus. Sometimes in our own lives, we have setbacks. We have doubt. We don't know what God is doing. And it almost always does start small. This morning, Jesus has this big world movement, but he also loves us deeply and is invested deeply in you and me personally. So let's take a moment, notice what he's doing, and give our attention to God. Let's pray. If you want to take a couple of deep breaths, we want to place distractions just on the shelf, give our attention to Jesus, open our hearts in a posture of receiving. Jesus, we do let it start small in our souls this morning. We pay attention to the whisperings of love, the divine nudges in our souls, those places where we just want more in our hearts, want more in our lives, Jesus. We open our hearts and our minds to your whisper, to your call on our lives and your call on our hearts this morning. Thank you, Jesus, that as you walked the earth, you called to individuals. You said, come, follow me, experience abundant life with me. This morning, we let our hearts heed that call to hear you calling us into abundant life. We receive, Jesus, your investment in us. You have poured into us mercy and grace. You have poured out to us forgiveness and second chances. We receive that, Jesus. We say this morning, we want to follow you. We want to be part of your big plans for us. We want to receive what only you can do for us. We cannot manufacture or produce the kind of inner life and peace that we can find in you. So our hearts say yes. We surrender. We will follow you, Jesus. We give you our attention this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let me tell you one of our core values, and that is the theology and the practice of the kingdom of God. It is the reality that Jesus Christ, in his coming, inaugurated the kingdom of God. In his second coming, he will consummate the kingdom of God. We live in the tension of the already and the not yet. Everything else from the Vineyard basically flows from this belief. This belief that God has intervened. God has kept his promise. There's a great way to talk about the kingdom of God. Let me give you a simple phrase. God has kept his promise. What he said he would do in Genesis 3:15, that he would intervene on behalf of the human race, he has done. He did it in sending his son. And Jesus, if I can give you a word picture of coming from Gordon Fee, Jesus drives a flag onto the earth and he says, this belongs to me. And yet, wrapping that all up is going to happen at the second coming of Christ. So everything we believe, everything that we take away from that, the kingdom of God, that's where we start. The theology and the practice of the kingdom of God is where we start in the Vineyard.
Yes. Church, good morning. It's great to be with you. And I want to talk to you this morning about the kingdom of God. Why the kingdom of God? Have you ever been around a toddler or an inquisitive child and they just ask the why question like again and again? It's like you walk into a room and the kid says to you, why you got an apple? And you're like, well, I like apples. Why? Well, they're delicious. They're crunchy and they're sweet and therefore I like them. Why? Well, they're good for you. Why? Well, because the nutritional value in an apple meets what your body needs. Why? Because pigs can't fly in the middle of July. I mean, you just get so frustrated. But on the other hand, you really want to encourage that kid to be asking all those why questions, because that's how they grow and that's how they learn. So why the kingdom of God? Why not? No, seriously, this is just a fantastic area. I mean, why preach in the kingdom of God? Well, maybe because Jesus thought it was really important. I mean, not just really important, but central. Why? Because the kingdom of God helps us from a theological standpoint to understand God. I mean, that's what theology is. How do we know God? How do we understand God? And Jesus was trying to teach us how we can get to know him and get to know God by talking and preaching on the kingdom of God. Well, why? Well, because it's not that obvious. I mean, Jesus realized that trying to get a handle on who God is and how we can relate to him was complicated. And so we ask the question, well, why? Well, we're going to look at the kingdom of God and we get to see what we can get out of it. And we will realize as we dig into it that there's a lot to get out of it. But let me ask you a question as to why. What do you know about the kingdom of God? How does the kingdom of God apply to your life? Why is that relevant? How does it impact your prayer life? What did Jesus say about it? And if some of these questions seem obscure, or how does that relate to the kingdom of God? I say, let's just dig in and look at the kingdom of God. I'd say these reasons why Jesus spoke about the kingdom of God. Well, firstly, do you realize that it's fundamental to understanding how we should pray? Jesus told us about the kingdom of God in the Lord's Prayer. What else might we have missed about the kingdom of God that seems so obvious? Well, how about the fact that the very first words that Jesus spoke in the Gospel of Mark and the very last words Jesus spoke in the Gospel of Mark were on the kingdom of God? I mean, that's got to be telling you something right there. I mean, it's obviously central and important to Jesus. But if we look at the other Gospels, Matthew and Luke, the very first, well, near almost the first thing, once Jesus dealt with the devil, the very next statement is about the kingdom of God. So that's interesting. Well, what about John the Baptist? When you think of John the Baptist, we think of John in the river, we think of things that he said, like, I'm not worthy to, tie or untie the sandals of Jesus. But John's first statement was about the kingdom of God. So John the Baptist made a big deal about the kingdom of God. We also know about the kingdom of God as it relates to eternity. Jesus had lots to say about that. But the other thing, which is kind of more mysterious and more interesting, is Jesus associated the Word of God with the kingdom of God, and particularly how the Word of God works in a mysterious yet very powerful way. And once we see it, we recognize it as we try and understand and wrestle with the Word of God, that the Word of God is alive, but for most people it seems dead. We'll look at that. The other thing which is particularly frustrating about the kingdom of God is that there's no formula. And we just like to try and get our hands around things, understand how the Holy Spirit works, how the power of God works, how we can use it and apply it and have regular results. And yet the kingdom of God is so helpful in saying, no, you can't do that. And yes, the power of God is real and we should expect it and depend on it. But it's not a formula. It's not formulaic. It might also be surprising to you that one of the greatest teachings that Jesus ever did, the Sermon on the Mount, starts off with the kingdom of God. So in other words, the kingdom of God is central to Jesus' teaching. It's throughout the New Testament. And yet, in many ways, we don't notice it. We just brush by it. We kind of like often miss the point. So let me just pray and ask that God will help me to help you get the point. Jesus, we just pray that you would empower my preaching. Lord, you made the kingdom of God central. And I just pray that we would grasp that. But not only that, you would empower what I'm saying. And Lord, that those that are hearing this, that you want to understand it, that you'd empower them through your Holy Spirit to apply what it is that you're saying to each of us with your teaching on the kingdom of God. Well, let's jump right in. Let's talk about the Lord's Prayer. This is the way it reads in Matthew 6, and I'm just going to read the beginning of it, verse 9 through 13. Now, the Lord's Prayer, if you read it in any modern translation, is kind of frustrating, quite honestly, because we've memorized the old King James Version. And so for that reason, the King James Version in the Lord's Prayer often is what is remembered. So for instance, it says this, and the opening line was, Jesus said to his disciples, "This is how you should pray. Pray like this." So it's kind of a big deal to our prayer language and to how to pray. And if we're trying to connect with God through prayer, which hopefully we are, Jesus is saying, you need to get this. And he says this, "Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name." Yes, great King James English, but very comforting because that's the way we've learned it. "Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." Wait. The kingdom of God, the big idea, is that Jesus is saying we want the kingdom to come on earth. And because we're praying, we're saying, God, help it to come by using us. And help us in our prayers to understand that you're in charge. And as we pray, we should be expecting the kingdom to come. And we should be expecting you to do something in us. And we should expect things to happen because of it. And our prayers should be focused around this line of thinking. Yes, you can ask for our daily bread and to forgive others. But can we stay with the central, the kingdom of God? Let's jump over to John the Baptist as he prepares the way. It says this in Matthew 3:1. "In those days, John the Baptist came to the Judean wilderness and began preaching. His message was, 'Repent of your sins and turn to God, for the kingdom of heaven is near.'" Now, one of the ways you know you're reading in the Gospel of Matthew is instead of the phrase kingdom of God, you see the phrase kingdom of heaven. But notice what John the Baptist says right out of the gate. "Repent of your sins. Turn to God. For the kingdom of heaven is near." Now, what's particularly interesting about this is if you look at your footnotes, you will see there's a dilemma here because on the word near, and in the footnotes, you will see it could be translated three different ways. The kingdom is near, or the kingdom has come, or the kingdom is coming soon. Now, That is actually a pretty big deal because it helps us to understand that the dynamics of the kingdom and of God, that God is both present tense, future tense, and past tense. Moses came up with this, came against this problem when he encountered God at the burning bush. He said to God, like, who are you? What are you going to call yourself? And God says, I am. My name is I am. Yahweh. And again, this creates the dilemma because it's got a past tense, present tense, and future tense meaning to that word. And here John the Baptist is picking that exact sense up again. Well, let's look at the first thing that it teaches about the kingdom of God as we look into the Gospels. In Mark chapter 1, verse 14, it says this. Later on, after John was arrested, Jesus went into Galilee, where he preached God's good news. And then Jesus talking, the time promised by God has come at last. He announced, the kingdom of God is near. Repent of your sins and believe the good news. Okay, Jesus is repeating what John said, repent of your sins, believe. But what we miss is that the tenses where it says God has come and yet God is near. Matthew 4:17. From then on, Jesus began to preach, repent of your sins and turn to God, for the kingdom of heaven is near. So why is this relevant? So why is this relevant to me? Well, if you don't know Jesus, then you ought to listen to the message of John the Baptist and Jesus. Repent of your sins and believe. It's the first step. It's the way you can encounter the love of God. It's the way that God makes sense. It's the way that we can experience God. We need to admit that God is real and that we are not perfect. And so that might be for you. That's the good news, that Jesus loves you and has a plan for you. That's the news that Jesus wants you to share. And his plan is different for each one of us. He knows you personally. But on the other hand, you might be a believer and you say, well, so what? Why? Why is this relevant to me? I'm a believer. I've repented. I do believe. Well, in Luke 9:2, it says this. Then he said to them, go out to tell everyone about the kingdom of God and to heal the sick. Oh. Okay, so Jesus is saying to the disciples, and then he's saying to us in the Great Commission, and also at the end of Mark, we need to do the same thing. Go out, tell others about the good news of Jesus, and heal the sick. Oh, very practical. And then we need to ask, how are we doing? How are we doing with that? So why? It's very relevant. But there's also something about the kingdom of God which is mysterious. It's mysterious the way the Bible works, the Word of God works, that understanding the kingdom of God, and Jesus explains this to us, we understand the mysterious power in the Bible, in the Word of God. Jesus used two parables, both related to sowing seeds and farming. And in Mark 4:11, he says this, the kingdom of God is a secret, and Jesus taught in parables. You know, farmer scattering seed. And then he says, but I'm going to tell you the secret. And explains the parable of the seeds. And yet, even as Jesus explains it to us, you say, well, okay, I get it at one level. but I don't get it at another level. We like the disciples. Mark 4:20 says this, "And the seed that fell on good soil represents those who hear and accept God's word and produces a harvest of 30, 60, and even 100 times as much as had been planted." Now all of a sudden, we ask ourselves, okay, how are we doing at inviting people to church? How are we doing at sharing the good news? Have you ever been frustrated because you invite somebody to church and they say no, or they're just disinterested, or you want to talk to somebody about God and they want to change the subject, they're not that interested in God? Have you ever noticed that it's mysterious? Like sometimes the person you least expect to have any interest in God and spiritual matters is rarely interested. And then there's other times you think, if so-and-so would just become a Christian, they would be an incredible asset to the kingdom. And it's like, really? In the kingdom of God, it's mysterious. God can use all sorts of people. He doesn't need people that you think are really, really great and awesome and wonderful leaders. He can use those people and anybody else. The kingdom of God is mysterious. In Mark 4:26, 27, Jesus also said, "The kingdom of God is like a farmer who scatters seed on the ground. Night and day, while he's asleep or awake, the seed sprouts and grows, but he has no understanding of how this happens." Friends, this is part of the secret or the mystery or the tension of the kingdom of God. God is asking us, instructing us, encouraging us to go out and do the things of the kingdom. Tell people about Jesus. Invite them to get to know him. Invite them to church. Heal the sick. Cast out demons. And we say, whoa, I don't have that gifting. I just want to do whatever you want to do. And God said, no, this is the basics. This is like step one. Do this. Then you will grow. Then you will mature. And we say, well, it's just such a mystery. I don't understand why it doesn't work when I try and why people don't respond. Therefore, it can't be my gift. And God is saying, no. That's the wrong understanding. The right understanding is it's mysterious. And God is in control, and we don't know the outcome. But just because we don't know the outcome doesn't mean that we shouldn't be scattering seeds and planting seeds and expecting them to grow and expecting some to fall on good soil, even if the majority don't. We shouldn't get discouraged. What about an understanding of the supernatural and how the power works and the kingdom of God? Well, again, if we look at some verses here, we looked at the one in Mark where it says the kingdom of God is near. And then we look at a different verse in Matthew. It says this, "But I am casting out demons by the Spirit of God. Then the kingdom of God has arrived among you." In other words, when miracles happen, it's because the kingdom of God has happened. It is present. Jesus is there. The power of the Holy Spirit is happening. The presence of God is present. And therefore, things happen. So it's not about only in the future. It's not about only in the past. It includes the past and it includes the future, but it also means right now. The kingdom of God is active. And so, again, we should take heed. Another way of looking at it is we live between two ages. We live between this present age, and we live hoping for eternity and to experience eternity. But with the kingdom of God, there's been this breakthrough where the future has broken into the present. And when you've received Jesus, when you know the God, when the power of the Holy Spirit is in you, you become what's known as born again, meaning you are now a new person. You are now a kingdom person. You now have eternity going for you. In other words, a future event, eternity, the thing that we think is going to happen when we die, has already happened when we accept Jesus. And as a result, some of the future things like being perfect body and 100% healing and no demonic oppression in heaven, we can experience and do experience now, presently. That's the mystery of the kingdom. But it's not something it's a formula. It's not something we can control. And it surprises us when God's power comes through. And it disappoints us, quite frankly, when we pray and nothing happens. But the solution isn't to give up praying for others and loving others and sharing the good news with others. The mystery of the kingdom is to press on, because we know that it's up to God. And it's a delight when we can partner with God and see God work in us and through us. So when Jesus died on the cross, it was like eternity was breaking into the present. This future event, the resurrection of the dead, when Jesus rose from the dead, is something we hope for. And we can have, you know, confident hope, because Jesus rose from the dead and we believe in Jesus, and he told us we'll rise from the dead. This end time event is happening with Jesus when he broke in. Let me just finish it this way. I said the Gospel of Mark started with the kingdom of God, Jesus preaching on the kingdom of God, and it ended with Jesus preaching about the kingdom of God. And the instructions Jesus gives us at the end of the Gospel of Mark are pretty powerful, maybe overwhelming, or maybe we just have to really be dependent on God and the excitement of the kingdom of God. So let me read this to you. Mark chapter 16, verse 15 onwards. And then he told them, go into all the world and preach the good news to everyone. Now this command is to you and to me. Preach the good news to everyone. Anyone who believes and is baptized will be saved, but anyone who refuses to believe will be condemned. These miraculous signs will accompany those who believe. No qualifications. They will cast out demons in my name. They will speak in new languages. They will be able to handle snakes with safety. And if they drink poison, anything poisonous, it won't hurt them. They will be able to place their hands on the sick and they will be healed. Wow. The kingdom of God. Now, I'm not like a real big fan of trying to handle snakes and testing God with drinking poison, but I am a big fan of telling people about the good news and praying for people to be healed and expecting demonic oppression to be lifted in the power of Jesus, seeing addictions broken. So, friends, the kingdom of God. It's really a wonderful topic. It's a great theology. It's practical theology. And that's why I wanted to preach on the kingdom of God. Bless you.
Well, thanks, Rob, for that. We want to pray for Jesus to show us more of the kingdom of God. But before we do that, I just want to read the last verse in the section Rob was talking about. Verse 20 of Mark 16. And the disciples went everywhere and preached, and the Lord worked through them, confirming what they said by many miraculous signs. The disciples continued out the work of Jesus after he left, because the kingdom of God was in them and was in our world. And so we just want to pray and we want to ask Jesus to show us our place in the kingdom, to ask Jesus to show us how we should be living this out in our world. So Sarah, do you want to pray?
Sure. Jesus, we thank you that your kingdom has such good things for us and for those around us, Jesus. Thank you that you have power and you are working on our behalf and for us, that you're still healing, you're still speaking, you're still guiding, And Jesus, we want to be part of that. Would you help each and every one of us listening to find our place and find our role in that? We know that you have good things for each and every one of us, things for each and every one of us to do, Lord God. I pray this week that each and every one of us would pray for someone around us, would receive your love and your joy and turn it out, praying for someone around them this week, Lord God. And we pray, Lord God, that we would just really place all our hope, all our stock in who you are and in what you're doing. Other things in this world disappoint us so frequently and let us down so frequently. We put our hope in you, Jesus, and what you're doing around us. Thank you that you are trustworthy and dependable. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Well, we're going to worship now, friends, and I just encourage you, pay attention to the lyrics of what we're singing. Let the words really sink in. Let your worship go up to Jesus. Let him know that you're engaging, that you're in this, and that you want more of him there with you. So let's worship.
I love you. My bed. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you, Jesus. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how it may look like. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
This is how I fight my battles. 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 This is how I.
Well, friends, it has been good to do church together. Follow us online. Check out Facebook website for some events coming up, ways you can partner, be involved. Connect with us, please. If you have anything that we can be praying for you for, we want to do that. Again, it's good to do church together. We love you. Thank you, and have a great week.